present our teacher, Lady Deborah, who does a fantastic job in expounding on the word of the Lord.
Yeah.
Hey.
Hey, everybody. What you gonna do when you get paid? What? I tell you what, the song is so true. The devil don't like it when you give God all the praise.
Amen.
But now we know where the blessing is. Amen. The blessing is in giving him the praise, because we realized this morning that we didn't do it, that he did it. And so we thank God for that this morning. We just praise God for his goodness, and we thank God for just how he keeps on blessing us anyway. And so thank God that, is Mother Bland over there? Okay, we have a student here. Student, Ariel, your teacher's here. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Pastor Bland. Amen. Praise the Lord. Want everybody to be comfortable. Everybody to get comfortable. Amen. We thank God for the study of the word this morning. We thank God for the judges stage, and thank God for each one of you, and how it's just been a blessing. It is a blessing to open up the word of God. It's a blessing to open up the word of God. You know, some people don't have that privilege. Some people, where they are, they can't even carry a Bible, or they would be, subject to persecution. But we are blessed to be able to carry our Bible. We got it on everything. We got it on an iPad. We got it on an iPhone. We got it, just in a hard copy. And we got all versions of it. And some of us, they tell me Jean has, maybe 20 different Bibles at her house. I don't know if that's true or not. But I know Jean. I know how she likes books. So I'm thinking that might be true. And so we thank God that we're able to have access to the Word of God.
Amen.
We have it on TV. We have it on the radio. And we're inundated with where we can receive the Word of God. Now, what we have to be cautious of, however, is if we're receiving it as being rightly divided. It's being rightly divided. And so we thank God that we have an opportunity to come to a place where the word is being rightly divided. So we're in the study of Judges. We're going through the Bible in stages. We're using Wilmington's stages. He has divided it into these stages. And we're using his curriculum to look at the stages of the Bible. And it just kind of helps us to put things in perspective and to put things in order. And I like that. So we are in the Judges stages. Turn with me, please, to Judges, the 9th chapter. We ended up talking about Abimelech last Sunday, talking about Abimelech and how he started out with selfish ambition, and how we talked about how a lot of times, Brother Carroy, when you start out with selfish ambition, it ends up tragically. And that's actually what happened to Abimelech. He started out with wanting to gain a kingdom and wanting to gather a kingdom unto himself, a kingdom, a headship that had been reserved for God at that time. At that time, Israel had no judge, not a judge, but they had no king. They had no king. And so that resulted with them doing what was right in their own eyes. You know, they thought about something, and if it felt good, they did it. If it felt right, they did it. And that caused them a lot of problems. Actually, kind of like being in self and being walking in the flesh and not walking in the spirit. How that causes us a lot of problems. You know, a lot of times we don't want to recognize it, and we don't want to call it what it is. We want to call it everything else but what it is, and it's just self.
Amen.
It's just self. And self will give us problems after problems after problems if we don't deal with what those things are. Amen? And so Abimelech ended his death. He ended with dying, and dying disgracefully. And so the kingdom that he so wanted, he ended up not having at all. he ended up not having at all. And so Judges chapter 9 and verse 57. Well, let's look at verse 55. And when the men of Israel saw that Abimelech was dead, they departed, every man unto his place. Thus God rendered the wickedness of Abimelech, which he did unto his father, in slaying his 70 brethren. And all the evil of the men of Shechem did God render upon their heads, and upon them came the curse of Jotham, the son of Jerubbaal. Jerubbaal being Gideon. And you remember that he was the one that was saved out of all of the brothers that Abimelech went to slay. He was saved and he hid himself and he came and cursed them. He cursed them. And so the curse that he laid upon them actually came true. It actually came true. And so now we come to a point in chapter 10. Are you there? And after Abimelech, there arose to defend Israel Tola, the son of Pua, the son of Dodo, a man of Issachar, and he dwelt in Shamir in Mount Ephraim. And he judged Israel 23 years and died and was buried in Shamir. And after him arose Jair, a Gileadite, and judged Israel 22 years. So put those years together, and how many years do you have? 45 years. When you put those years together, you have 45 years. So the people of Israel, as you see on the screen there, enjoyed peace and security for 45 years under the leadership of Tola and Jair. Now, we don't know very much about them, save what's in the scriptures that we're reading. But we can surmise from what we're reading that if they enjoyed that amount of time with peace and security, that they had to have been faithful men in order to have that much peace and security. And so they serve the Lord and they serve the nation well. Anytime you have peace, when you've been in turmoil, how many of you know about that? You've been in turmoil, and anytime you can get any kind of peace, you happy about that. And so Israel, however, I'm going to tell you something about Israel. Israel was just hard-headed, and they just never learned their lesson, just like us. You know, I always say, it reminds me of us, has a hard time learning a lesson. So in the 45 years of peace and security, it would seem like they would be calling on the Lord. It would seem like they would take that opportunity to use that time to draw closer to the Lord and use that time to find out about themselves and to just, you know, ask the Lord to help them. But Israel actually is in a period of spiritual decay. They're in a period of spiritual decay, and you tell me if you can identify with this and if you think that this is important, because they were decaying because of their lack of gratitude, their lack of submission to the Lord, and their lack of adequate leadership. Now, you think all three of those are necessary? All three of those are necessary, aren't they? So you got to have some gratitude in your life, especially when you're talking about what the Lord has done for you. When you think about it, if you sit back and look around, is there anything that you can take the credit for? Is there anything at all that you can take the credit for? There's nothing at all you can take the credit for. Now, we call that grace, and we call that mercy. You know, I was thinking about mercy the other day, and I was thinking about mercy in this respect. To me, mercy is synonymous with help. Mercy is synonymous with help. Because anytime someone has mercy on you, they're helping you. They're helping you. They're helping you. It's something that you're in a situation that you need somebody to look down on you and extend a hand. They don't have to do it, but they do it. They give you some help. They offer you a lifeline when they offer you mercy. And that's what God does for us every day. every day we get up, the Bible says that new mercies he extends to us every day. And so I thank God for his help on this morning, because I realized this morning that if it had not been for him, I would be lost somewhere like cuckoo, just cuckoo, out of my mind. You know, on a corner looking crazy, and y'all would be passing by me saying, what is she doing on a Sunday morning? She knows she need to be in church. But the Lord had mercy on me, and I thank God for his mercy. And so another thing then was their lack of submission. Israel was hard-hearted and stiff-necked, had a stiff neck, lack of humility. Lack of humility. And so you can't get anything from the Lord if you're stiff-necked.
That's right.
Can't get anything but a whipping.
That's
nothing
right.
But a whipping. Because he resists the proud.
Yeah.
But he gives grace and more grace and more grace to the humble. And so you have to be in a place where you're grateful, and you have to be in a place where your heart is pliable. Now, what I mean by that is you have to be in a place where somebody can tell you something. You cannot be resistant to help. If you're resistant to help, you won't get the mercy that you need. And every one of us in here, you don't fool yourself. Every one of us in here, we need help. We need help. Every one of us. And so they lack gratitude, they lack being submissive to the Lord, and then they lack adequate leadership. And don't fool yourself again. It says something. The leader that you have, so goes the congregation, so goes the people that's following. You know, and let me tell you something that we read about leadership is that if you are too beneath you, if servanthood is beneath you, then leadership is beyond you. So you got to have a leader that's first willing to serve. You got to have a leader that's first willing to serve, which means that the leader has to be humble himself. The leader has to be humble himself and can't always be the one that wants the credit for it. And don't, if you hadn't been for me, you wouldn't have what you have. And you know, y'all looking around, y'all need to be, instead of y'all thinking, I heard somebody say, instead of you thanking the Lord, you need to be thanking me. You know, you got leaders like that. You have leaders like that. And then you look at the people that's following them, and you said, no wonder they like they are. Because the leader is like he is, or the leader is like she is. And so they needed some adequate leadership. Adequate leadership. You can have a leader, but the leadership cannot or doesn't have to be adequate.
That's right.
You know, everybody can't lead.
Right.
Everybody can't lead. You know, and a lot of people, a lot of times, leaders make it look easy. But some people, at the first sign of distress, they fall all out. If all that first sign somebody talk about them, they fall all out. And I'm going to tell you something. If you're a leader, you're going to be talked about. If you're a leader, you will be ridiculed. If you're a leader, you will be shamed and embarrassed. But it's all in the making of you to be an adequate leader. It's all in the making of you being an adequate leader. So they had none of that. So they were on the spiritual decline. They were on a spiritual decline. And you know, we could see it coming. We had the Bible and we could read. So we could see it coming from a long way off. Is that they're getting ready to go back and do the same thing they've been doing. And so Israel subjected themselves time and time again to humiliation only because of their lack of gratitude and their lack of submission and their lack of leadership. And so it says here, I'm in chapter 10, and we're talking about just Jair and Tola, how they must have been good leaders because they had that time of security for so long. And so, as I said earlier, they didn't take advantage of those 45 years. You know, they could have, it could have helped them to grow. And let me tell you something, people of God. We need to grow. We need to grow. We don't need to be satisfied with staying in the same place. We don't need to get complacent. We don't need to look at ourselves and say, I don't need anymore, or that's enough, or it's no sense in me doing that. We need to continue to grow, continue to grow, continue to mature on a spiritual basis, continue to mature on a spiritual basis. And so you would have thought that at this point, Israel would know that their blessings are connected to them being obedient.
And Lady Deborah, I need to be sure that I don't confuse getting promotions in the church with spiritual growth.
Elaborate on that.
Well, just trying to get another title or trying to get recognized in the church, that does not necessarily mean I'm growing spiritually.
Amen. And on that same vein, just because you're busy doesn't mean you're growing either. Just because you're working. A lot of people think that means I'm growing, and a lot of people think that means I'm doing something. But if you're working and doing, and you're not getting anywhere, and you still haven't moved, you're not doing anything.
Well, Lady Deborah, I guess the only insurance against that is by staying in the Bible.
Amen. I believe that. And so now, as I said, they should have known that by now. Okay, God blesses us when we're obedient. Isn't that what he told them in Deuteronomy 28? He said, okay, if you do this, they had this long litany of things that if they abided by, that they would be blessed. And then on the other hand, it was this long list of things that if they did those or if they didn't do those, then they would be cursed. So you would have thought that they would have known that if they were disobedient, they would be chastened or disciplined, and that if they were obedient, they would be blessed. But they did not. They had not matured to that extent. So the conditions of the covenant, go over to Judges, the 8th chapter, or not Judges, go over to Joshua, the 8th chapter. Joshua, the 8th chapter, and let's look at verse 30. Okay, are you there? Joshua 8 and 30. Then Joshua built an altar unto the Lord God of Israel in Mount Ebal. As Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded the children of Israel, as it is written in the book of the law of Moses, an altar of whole stones over which no man hath lift up any iron, and they offered thereon burnt offerings unto the Lord and sacrificed peace offerings. And he wrote there upon the stones a copy of the law of Moses, which he wrote in the presence of the children of Israel. And all Israel and their elders and officers and their judges stood on this side the ark, and on that side before the priests, the Levites, which bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord, as well the stranger as he that was born among them, half of them over against Mount Gerizim and half of them over against Mount Ebal, as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded before, that they should bless the people of Israel. And afterward, he read all the words of the law, the blessings and cursings, according to all that is written in the book of the law. There was not a word of all that Moses commanded, which Joshua read not before all the congregation of Israel, with the women and the little ones and the strangers that were conversant among them. And so what excuse did they have? Because they knew where their blessings came from. There was no excuse at all. It was told to them from the time of Moses through the time of Joshua. Sometimes, you know, they would remember it when they got into trouble, you know. They would remember it, and then they would begin to call on the Lord. So I have a question for you, and my question is this. Comfortable living often produces weak character. What do you think? Comfortable living often produces weak character.
I think I just have to drop my head.
Can you think about that in your own life? And I guess that's why he would say that. He would have to drop his head. How many of you can say this? That there has been times and periods in my life where I've had more. Where I had petitions before the Lord. And the Lord granted those petitions. And I was like hungry, I was thirsty, and I was seeking after the Lord while I was petitioning him. But when he granted those petitions, I sat back and folded my arms and crossed my legs and said, I got it now. I got it now. How many of us can say that there has been periods in our lives when our children are not in jail? And our husband comes home every night. Our husband has been relieved from his substance abuse. He's no longer drinking, and he's no longer drugging, and he's no longer womanizing. And so I was calling on the Lord, send him home, Lord. Let him come on home. Lord, help him, deliver him. And when the Lord answered my prayer, I sat back and said, all right, Lord, I got it now. How many of us can say that there was a job that we wanted, money that we needed, and the Lord made a way? We were calling on him, beating the door down, trying to just run it over everybody, getting into the church. But when the Lord came through and answered our call, we stopped coming to church. We stayed in bed and said, you know, I need to rest. The Super Bowl is coming on tonight. I got to get ready for the Super Bowl party. How many of us can say that? That we get comfortable where we are. Now, you know, we don't call it comfortable. What we say is, well, you know, everybody get tired. Everybody get tired, and everybody need a break.
Well, this is our favorite thing. You got to have some sense for yourself.
All right now. And the Lord gave you 5 cents.
I hear Pastor. I hear Pastor, but you got to have some sense for yourself. Now, Deborah, before that, when they was in trouble, everything I said was coming straight from God.
So true. And so are we all in agreement with that? If you agree with that statement, let me see you raise your hand. All right, you can let your hand down. So then comfortable, let's just remember that then. Let's remember that. Sister Jean?
I'm going back.
Okay.
Looking at the different gods that these people were worshiping, it makes me, I thought about, they have a head knowledge of the law of Moses, but it wasn't in their heart.
Okay.
So whenever they can encounter other people and they were serving a different God from our God, then they fail for it. And then I think about looking at us. I'm talking about African Americans.
All right.
Looking at us and how God has blessed us. And we have not done a good job of teaching our children about where we came from, how we were blessed, and what God did for us.
All right.
We have done a good job of that.
All right.
And I'm looking at these people and the gods they are worshiping. We may not worship those gods, but our children worship gods. And it's not our God.
All right.
They worship clothes. They worship all that long hair hanging down their backs. They worship phones. Those iPads, you know, it irritates me to see, and when you see them, never a book, never. Their eyes are constantly on that phone or those iPads.
Well, you know,
so
you had to pull in everybody on that one.
I'm talking about that.
Yeah, all right.
And we haven't done a good job of letting our descendants know that we haven't always been where we are
now. I would agree with that. I would agree with that. I would also say that you all, this is Black History Month, okay? You don't even have to go all the way back to slavery. All right? You don't have to go back when we came over on the boat. All I had to do is just look back down to Marianna, Arkansas. All I had to do is look back to when my mama was out in the cotton field. And then the children, when they were big enough to pick cotton, that they were all in the cotton field too. And so, you know, we don't have to go way, way back. All we had to do is look back just a few days down the road and how things are so much better for us. And we won't even share that. We won't even share that. So I agree with you on that.
Lady Deborah, I agree and I disagree, and I disagree to this extent. We are teaching our children. And children learn by watching you. And so we're just at a state of just ingratitude. We're just not for what God has done for us. It doesn't even have anything to do with salvation. For what God has done for us, we're not grateful. And you can just look at us and tell you. And so I appreciate the lesson. I said to him, I said, you're helping me. Because it's just a tendency of human beings to just take. And that's what we have become. We have just become takers. And instead of giving, and that's the reason our community has not thrived. Helen is almost ready for tumbleweeds to be going down the middle of it. You know, it's almost deserted, and it didn't have to be that way. When I first came back here in the early 90s, there was 7 black lawyers here. And if we, I conclude myself, if we had stood up like we should have, then we could have lift. You lift as you climb. You know, everybody can't help. If you're already down at the bottom, you can't help nobody. But when God has blessed you to be able to help, but instead of that, you know, we were selfish and we were just so glad to have something ourselves, and we exploited just like we was being exploited.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you all for those comments. Okay, so now we're at a point. And that Tolar and JR, they've died. They've been buried. And what do you think happens? Chapter 10, verse 6, and the children of Israel did evil again in the sight of the Lord, and served Balaam and Ashtaroth and the gods of Syria and the gods of Zidon and the gods of Moab and the gods of the children of Ammon and the gods of the Philistines, and forsook the Lord and served not him. And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he sold them into the hands of the Philistines and into the hands of the children of Ammon. And that year they vexed and oppressed the children of Israel. How long? 18 years. All the children of Israel that were on the other side Jordan in the land of the Amorites, which is in Gilead. Moreover, the children of Ammon passed over Jordan to fight also against Judah and against Benjamin and against the house of Ephraim, so that Israel was sore distressed. And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord. Now, see, you've had time. You've had some time. You've had some time. But now you wait right until you start doing what you want to do. You start doing what you want to do, what you're big enough to do. You start doing what gives you pleasure. And what gave them pleasure was serving those other gods, serving those other gods. And so now they're crying out, but now JR and Tola, they're off the scene, so they don't have anybody to stand up for them. They don't have anybody to stand up for them.
Lady Deborah, would you agree with this? I think you talk about rightly dividing. I think the problem with reading all of this and listening to it and interpreting it is that, you know, you said God tells Israel that if you will obey me, I'll bless you.
Mm-hmm.
And that if you don't, then I'm going to curse you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, us not understanding the Bible, we think that he's talking about salvation. That if you do right, then you're going to be blessed. And if you don't do right, then you won't be blessed. Basically, that's what I was taught.
Okay.
When in fact, Israel was just like if we have somebody that represents us, all of us don't go to Washington. We send a representative up there, and he goes up there. We're not there, but he's representing us. If he goes up there and go to acting up or whatever, then we don't want him because he's not representing us. Israel was God's representative on the earth.
Mm-hmm.
They were the light of the world. They were the salt of the earth. They were the only people who knew and served the true and living God. All the nations around them served gods, but not the true and living, mm-hmm. not Jehovah.
Right.
He revealed himself unto the nation of Israel.
Yeah.
And so if his only representative has gone with the other people, a horn after other gods, then he has no light, no representative on this earth. And so then in Deuteronomy 28 and Leviticus 27, he tells them that if you don't serve me, then I'm going to take you out of this land. I'm going to disperse you. All these promises that I promised you, you're not going to have it anymore. You think that's fair?
I think that's fair.
Okay.
I think that's fair. I do. Anyone else? Praise the Lord. Man, you are an awesome-looking group this morning. I want you to know that. We're in Judges chapter 10. And we are in verse 10. So now Israel is being humiliated because, you know, there's nothing they can do against the nations that are coming up against them. There's nothing they can do. And so they're in a period now of chastening. They're in a period of discipline. And, Pastor?
It's just amazing to me that I was never taught this. But what I always have to keep in mind that these people were not working toward salvation.
Right.
Their forgiveness came once a year on the Day of Atonement, and it was by blood. It wasn't by them keeping the commandments. It wasn't by them acting right.
Mm-hmm.
And so what they're suffering from is for their breaking the covenant. He cut covenant with Israel. This was his covenant people, evidenced by the circumcision in Genesis 17. And so this has nothing to do with whether God loves them. It has nothing to do with whether they're saved or not. It has everything to do with them being his representative on this earth. In fact, I believe on Wednesday nights, we're getting ready to make a turn, and I'm getting ready to do a study on the nation of Israel.
Okay.
Because we just don't, you know, if we don't understand Israel, we don't understand the Bible.
And that'll be a great study, won't it?
Mm-hmm. I have a question I want to ask. Is that when God turned away from Israel, is that the time when he moved over to the Gentiles and brought in grace? Is that what some of the purpose or reason why he changed?
Because they rejected him. That's why he allowed
the
that's why, because they rejected him. They never recognized him as the Savior. They never recognized him as the Messiah.
And so that's what they done there. So by him putting them to the side, only just for a short time.
For a season. It allowed us
come back and deal with the Jews, with Israel.
Yes. And you can find that in Romans. Yeah. You can find that in the book of Romans.
Right. Chapter 11.
He takes care of them.
But just, yeah.
When they get in trouble, because there was
I don't remember, but I was watching TV.
Mm-hmm.
And this Israelite was talking about the minefield that was around them and how God led them through the minefield.
Uh-huh.
They never
uh-huh.
stepped on a mine. And then I was looking at something about 3 weeks ago, and they were the soldiers were battling someone, and a huge sandstorm appeared, and the opposite folk could not see those soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
So he still looks out for them, just as he looks out for us. You know, we may not do right, but he's still looking out.
Certainly.
And taking care.
He's still
of
God.
Us.
He's still God. And so, Brother Davis, Romans chapter 11, And you don't have to go there, but it just says, I say then, this is Paul talking, have God cast away his people? And his people being who?
The nation of Israel.
God forbid. For I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God hath not cast away his people, which he foreknew. Want ye not what the scripture saith of Elijah? How he maketh intercession to God against Israel, saying, Lord, they have killed the prophets and dig down thine altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life. But what saith the answer of God unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Even so then, at this present time also, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And so, very good. Thank you for the question and very good observation. Okay, so let's go back to Judges. Let's go back to Judges chapter 10. Okay, so now they're at a point where they're crying out to the Lord. And as Gene alluded to earlier about the gods that they were serving, God had delivered them from seven nations. But in his delivering them from seven nations, they served the God of those seven nations. It says here, and the Lord said unto the children of Israel, and it's something when the Lord has to be the one to bring to your remembrance what he's done for you. When, in fact, all we have to do, all they had to do, all we had to do is just look around. Just look around and be reminded of what he's done. The Lord said, did not I deliver you from the Egyptians and from the Amorites, from the children of Ammon and from the Philistines? The Zizonians also and the Amalekites and the Moabites did oppress you, and ye cried to me, and I delivered you out of their hands. Yet ye have forsaken me and served other gods. Therefore, I will deliver you no more. Go and cry unto the gods which you have chosen. Isn't it the Lord that's got indignant with them? Then you crying out, and you serving them, and you think they can help you. Go and cry out to them. Let them deliver you in a time of your tribulation. Let them deliver you in the time of your tribulation. And the children of Israel said unto the Lord, we have sinned. Do thou unto us whatsoever seemeth good unto thee. Deliver us only, we pray thee this day. True repentance? No. True repentance? No. True repentance? No. They did not have a true change of mind. All they wanted to do was save their behind. Isn't that the truth? We're in hot water. Amen. We're in hot water. And we just need some help. Amen. We need some help. Amen. Not a change of mind, because if it had been a true change of mind, they wouldn't find themselves where they are now. They would not find themselves where they are. It says, whatsoever seemeth good unto thee, deliver us only, we pray thee this day. And they put away the strange gods from among them and served the Lord. And his soul was grieved for the misery of Israel. I'm talking about now a merciful God. I'm talking about a merciful God. Then the children of Ammon were gathered together and encamped in Gilead. And the children of Israel assembled themselves together and encamped in Mizpah. And the people and princes of Gilead said one to another, what man is he that will begin to fight against the children of Ammon? He shall be head over the inhabitants of Gilead. And so now they are getting themselves together. They're ready to fight, but they have no one to lead them. They have no one to lead them. And so in order to get someone to volunteer to say that, they would come to lead them, they promised that that person would be named head over Gilead. And now is where we begin to talk about this next character in chapter 11, and that's Jephthah. Jephthah was a Gileadite. The Bible says that he was a mighty man of valor. That he was the son of a harlot. And Gilead begat Jephthah. And so it says, Gilead's wife bare him sons, and his wife's sons grew up, and they thrust out Jephthah and said unto him, thou shalt not inherit in our father's house. Now, it was Jephthah's father, too. Okay? But the fact of the matter is, though, they had different mothers. Now, I don't know if you all come, you know, from a household like that. They call them blended households. But there's sometimes trouble in a blended household unless the people in the house are mature enough in accepting of the discretions of the father or the discretions of the mother. And so they said, thou shalt not inherit in our father's house, for thou art the son of a strange woman. Then Jephthah fled from his brethren and dwelt in the land of Tob. And there were gathered vain men to Jephthah and went out with him. So to transition from this, and we don't have a lot of time, but for the last few minutes that we do have, I want to talk just a little bit about rejection. Talk a little bit about rejection. How many of you can say you've ever been rejected? Rejected. Okay, you know. And how many of you can say that rejection doesn't feel good?
No.
Rejection doesn't feel good, does it? Really doesn't feel good if you're going to go and you're going to bring up my pedigree.
All right.
Bring up my, don't you talk about where I came from. Trying to make me feel like you better than I am because your mama was not a harlot. Come on, now. I'm just as good as you. But rejection, when you're rejected, you don't feel like that. Because rejection messes with your self-esteem. Rejection messes with your ego. And what rejection says is they didn't think I was good enough. They didn't think I was good enough. And a lot of times when you're rejected, and this is what the devil intends, rejection causes you to feel like nobody wants you. I'm not good enough. So you go somewhere and you sit down. You go somewhere, you ostracize yourself. Or what you do is you isolate yourself, because I saw a meme that said, you know what? If I don't talk to nobody, can't nobody hurt me. I know how to fix that. And so rejection causes you to not be a risk taker. But how many of you know if you live in this world, you're going to have to take some risk? You're going to have to take some risk. So rejection brings with it feelings of shame, feelings of sadness, and feelings of grief. And I tell you what, it depends on the type of rejection it is. You can have romantic rejection. You can have social rejection. Now, they tell me, and what I've read is that a romantic rejection is just like somebody stabbing you in the heart. It's like, and if you think I'm lying, why do you think people stalk people? Why do you think you have ex-lovers, ex-husbands, you have ex, you know, but you, they're ex, so that means, okay, that you're done. Ex means somebody rejected them, okay? Somebody said, I don't want you anymore. Somebody said, I don't want you anymore. But what your mind is telling you, no, you might not want me, but I still want you. And so what they do is, then they stalking the people. People got to call the police. People got to put out a restraining order. They're like, leave me alone. I told you I didn't want you. But rejection is so painful, and it deals with your psyche so much that you're going to make the people just, you're going to make the people do what you want them to do. And so you've got to, you know, I'm looking at Jephthah and I'm talking about rejection, because that's what he was rejected. He was cast out because of where he came from. Something that he had nothing to do with. Nothing to do with. And you think about your children. You think about children, just not even, doesn't have to be your children. But you think about children are so mean.
Amen.
They are so mean.
Yes.
They are so mean, and they will tear a child up. They'll cause him, they'll do it on purpose. You know, have you seen them? They go and they gather in the little groups, and they got, we not talking to you. You know, and it doesn't have to be, it could be, she too fat. We don't want to be around her. She too dark. He can't, And it hurts. It hurts.
I think that's something that affects a child or anybody. That'll have effect on them the rest
yes,
of their life.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
Lady, I was just thinking that. I'm still hurt. I am. I'm hurt right now by some things that were said to me when I was a child.
Yeah.
It goes all the way back to childhood. It goes all the way back to Jackie. Yes, it is. Yes, 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 yes. You know, they disguise it as church hurt. But you know what it really is, Jackie? They've been wanting to do that all along. You know what I'm saying? Come on now. Let's just be real. I'm like Noah Jones. I'm going to talk to some grown folks after a while. You know, act like you don't know. No, people ugly. People can get ugly. And they do what they've been wanting to do all along. Mm-hmm. And then they glory, and I know, you know, I'm speaking in generalizations. Everyone doesn't do this, but a lot of times they glory in seeing you hurt. They feel good about it. Feel good about it. You know, walk around with a smirk on their face. Now look at you now. What you gonna do now? And a lot of times, even in the church, Jackie, what they'll do is click up.
And Lady Deborah. That's the reason I have this feeling and this leadership style is that if I believe that what they're doing is trying to hurt you, I'll put all of them out. There won't be nobody left but me and you. I will.
But what we have to do, though, is rejection. We have to take a depth that is going to help us. Because what we're going to see with Jephthah is that he did not let his rejection keep him in a space. He didn't let his rejection keep him in a place where, you know, he didn't have mercy on Israel. He had mercy on them. Because he could have, and which he did, he did. He came to him and said, well, now, just like the Lord said, now you've been calling on the other God, go to the other gods so they can deliver you. Jephthah, they came to Jephthah to ask for his help. And Jephthah was like, oh, no, I know you don't want me. Yeah, you the same ones that put me out. But now y'all want me to come? So, you know, he could have been all, you know, he just could have walked around for a while and made him feel bad and just, you know, and just played with him for a while. But he got past his rejection. And a lot of times, thanks to God, that's what we have to do. We had to move past our rejection. Because all of us, like I said, if we haven't experienced it, and I know we have. You don't get to be too old before you start experiencing rejection in some form or fashion. But you have to become mature enough, which Israel really did never get mature, but we have to become mature enough to understand what it is that we're going to be hurt, we're going to be rejected, everyone's not going to receive us. You know, we would think and we would hope that, you know, everybody we're around would just love us and accept us, but it's not a fact of life. It's not a fact of life. But we have to be mature enough to move past our rejection. So we're going to pick up with Brother Davis is coming. It's going to be the last coming, and we'll pick up here next Sunday. That's a good point. That's a good point. That's a great point. That's a great point. So we'll pick up here and start with Jephthah. Did you want something? We'll pick up here next Sunday. Give the Lord a hand, praise everybody.